Okay.
Okay. Okay, welcome everyone to the November 21st Committee on Community Resources meeting. I'm going to call the meeting to order. I'm going to note that we are being audio and video recorded. And Pam, could you quickly call the roll?
I can. Counselor Bailoff?
Here.
Counselor Carney?
Here.
Counselor Klein?
Here.
Counselor Sheriff?
Here. I note there is no public for public comment. So we will skip ahead to the approving the minutes from our last meeting, which was October 17th, 2016. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion on them?
I had a spelling change.
Okay.
We referred to Pam Schwartz, and it's S-C-H-W-A-R-T-Z.
Good catch.
As opposed to, and that's in two places. It's in the narrative, and it's also in the list of people to invite to the meeting about Pam Hanlon. And then I was pretty sure in the regarding arts, the list of people that we brainstormed, that I had mentioned a couple other folks, and I'd like them added. Somebody from the Arts Trust, somebody from the Center for the Arts, as two other people that definitely would need to be part of that. And that's all I have for
today. Any further discussion? All those in favor with those amendments from Councilor Klein?
Aye.
No objections or extensions. Okay, so next on our agenda is to approve our calendar for 2017.
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
A second.
Discussion on the calendar and these dates. So looks like in January, normally we would meet on the 16th, but that is a city holiday. What holiday is that? So instead, we would meet on the 23rd. And then April, instead of meeting on Monday, April 17th, we would meet on Tuesday, April 18th. Does that work for everybody?
I'd like to make a suggestion that we think about skipping our August meeting or our July meeting, as is sometimes the practice.
I think this past year we did July, but skipped August. Right, everyone?
It does, and I like the spirit of that suggestion. And
does anyone have thoughts or feelings on July or August?
No, I just don't know what
I have
planned. I do have a glimmer of an August vacation plan, but I mean, if others were indifferent as to which, I'd rather meet in July and skip August.
That would probably be my preference as well, but we can also be. Yeah. We can revisit this.
It takes me till July to make my summer plans.
Right. Okay, so we will plan, as of right now, we're going to plan to take the August 21st date off the calendar. And looks like October 23rd, Pam was noting that's the fourth Monday.
Mm-hmm.
And other than that, follows our normal schedule. So any further discussion about the calendar? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No objections, abstentions? So we're going to do this for another year, people. Okay, so the next item on our agenda looks just like last month, which is we're going to continue the discussion we've been having about our findings from the community study request. And how we proceed forward And I know that Councilor Bidwell and I met with the mayor and had a very interesting, good meeting with him. And based on what we discussed with him, Councilor Bidwell has put together sort of a, what do you call it, a plan?
Well, I think what we sort of took away from that meeting was that in a lot of ways we're kind of back to the notion that we really do need a report of some sort. And so I offered, based on conversations that Councilor Char and I had and our meeting with the mayor, I offered to put together just an outline of what might be such a plan, including, you know, an outline of what some of the recommendations in that plan might be. So I intended it as nothing more than a starting point for conversation. And if we work our way through it, we can talk about some of the substance of what we talked about the mayor.
Right.
As we hit on those topics.
Shall we pass it, right?
I think we should.
Easily digestible.
In
bulleted.
A few bullets, and I tweaked it.
Do you need one?
No, I have one. I have one.
Oh, then I'm.
I tweaked it midday, so I figured, gosh, if I got it out by then, probably would never get out before the meeting anyway. So you're seeing it for the first time. And you know, a lot of this is still obviously just very much in my own mind. It's still taking shape, and I'm not totally clear myself on some of this, but this a lot of this looks a little bit like the outline that we talked about last time, but this is more in the an outline of what a report with embedded recommendations would look like. And you just in broad outline, I would imagine some kind of intro that just recaps how we got to this place and reviews the different kinds of recommendations that we're making, and then dive right in to recommending some form of cooperation with the mayor and convening a forum on the arts and events promotion. Not dissimilar from what we talked about last time, but informed a little bit by our conversation with the mayor. The kind of forum that Councilor Klein indicated some interest in playing a role in. And then, and I'll just give you a broad overview, and then we'll obviously want to talk in considerable detail about all the pieces, but there was a very helpful response from the mayor regarding this notion of some kind of task force on panhandling and at-risk downtown populations. My characterization of it, I'm curious how you would describe it, Councilor Shaw, was that he did acknowledge that we no doubt heard an awful lot about this issue, and he could understand that we feel compelled to do something, to say something. But he said, rather than you as a committee taking the lead in trying to pull together some task force that would have some city cooperation, perhaps it would be more appropriate for you to ask me, the mayor, to convene such a task force. Mm-hmm. And so that's the notion here.
I'll just add, additionally, he said that these are conversations that are already happening in City Hall as well, and that since there are multiple departments that are already in conversation about this, that, you know, we don't want to duplicate efforts, but also he felt like it was certainly appropriate for us to indicate that we feel like this is an important thing for them to work on and maybe make some recommendations about it. But since it is city departments and they're already talking about it, that it wouldn't make sense to have a separate task force or some kind of meeting.
And that was, frankly, quite a sigh of relief on my part, since I was the one who stuck my neck out and offered to play some role in organizing, convening such a thing. I do think it's more appropriate that the mayor, in combination with other folks, take a And then, just as broad overview, and obviously, I expect you folks, Councilors Klein and Carney, to tweak and offer an update, but with regard to worker issues, to consider whatever draft ordinance and resolutions are working their way, and whatever other things we could do in support of relevant state legislation. And then what we talked, and we touched on this last month, was with regard to perhaps what we need to do with the more kind of downtown economy per se is to maybe do some combination of op-ed pieces and perhaps a council resolution that summarizes what we've learned, a lot of the facts and figures, some of it setting the record straight, and then one that's more, well, what can people do to be more supportive of a healthy downtown economy? And then it seemed like a lot of the items that sort of fell into the basket of referring them elsewhere were referrals to the transportation department. So that's the very, very broad outline. And do I have a plan for, you know, how such a report would actually be drafted? No, we, you know, don't have our contracted consultant to write the reports. That's one thing we need to talk about. But anyway, that's a jumping off.
Right. So this is actually an outline of a federal report. This isn't the report.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Although I would not imagine a lengthy tome. I would imagine, you know, short and to the point. But obviously filling in a lot of detail.
And the report would not include outcomes of forums or whatever. It would be just the recommendations to do them, right?
Well, yeah, I think so, because, you know, we issued the one report which sort of summarized all of our process and attached all the minutes and even attached that tabulation, didn't it? I think so. You know, the tabulation of how many people spoke about this, how many people spoke about
the one that Jonathan did?
Yeah, the one that Jonathan and I worked on. Well, that could be an attachment to this. The first part would be the recap of what we did, a summary of what we heard, with some numbers attached, with the caveats about what the numbers do and don't mean. That could all be part of the setting of the context in the intro, but then it would kind of dive right into the meat. At least that's one what it might look like.
An update on timeline might change some of this stuff here in terms of whether legislation comes before we would get a report.
Right, right.
And what, should I give a little update on that? I think the last time I updated, it's really, things have taken a while to get clarified with Alan T. Walt's office and the mayor. And some of that was just people had away for 10 days and then this happened. What Alan did determine was that, you know, there's clearly in our charter sets apart the parts that would be under the auspices of the mayor and the parts of wage theft legislation that would be under the city council. And that would be looking at it in three different areas, in the area of licenses, in procurement, four, and the CPA, and in TIF language. So, and it was clear that the procurement piece and the TIF piece is administered by the mayor's office, and that would fall under his jurisdiction. And all of the licenses, except for the handful that the city council has jurisdiction over. So, but given that, he said that he was willing to write an executive order, based on kind of the draft that And that's the draft that I had emailed around to folks that was like rough draft. That was a good month and a half ago. So based on that, what Alan did was he drafted a possible executive order that wouldn't come until the pieces that the city council needs to consider come to the city council, get referred to whichever committees, and then come back to the city council. And it's only two pieces. It's one that the city council, and it's on duplicate language in terms of dealing with licenses, but would require license applicants for which it has jurisdiction to attest to being in compliance with wage and hour law. It's essentially what it says. And then the other is the CPA ordinance. So that one, that part would be an order. The ordinance amendment would be to the CPA ordinance. I forget which number it is, but that would add a section to our CPA legislation that refers to wage compliance. And same thing, prospective applicants would need to attest to wage compliance. There's some additional, and everything was ready to move forward, but there was some additional language that we were kind of working in collaboration with some of the folks who spoke at the forum, with the Carpenters Union, especially around the CPA issue, especially since they brought up the incidents that had happened up at Christopher Heights and had a lot of concerns around that. So what they said was there was some specific language that they, that actually what it did is it had clawback reference, so that if a recipient, a CPA recipient, actually did engage in unlawful practices during the course of their grant, then they would be subject to return the grant amount back to the city. So I mean, there's a lot of, so we're waiting on that. That's what I was hoping that I would get some of that today and send it to Alan and have him kind of just make sure it's okay. And then, but it looked like then things would move forward where those two pieces would come to the city council on December 1st. And I think that's still the plan. And then from there, I guess they would go at least to legislative matters and should, and I think they should come here because we still have, would still be within the month of, if they came in December 1st, we'd still, I think we meet the 15th?
It's the 1st and the 15th of December.
Yeah, so our meeting is the 15th. So we'd consider, because we would need to consider it before Legislative Matters does. They always take
a matter. Sewald, for some reason, said that it shouldn't come here. I mean, he does, it's not like he has jurisdiction over that decision, but he said it should only really go to Ledge, so.
Oh, I think that, yeah, in their conversation, they weren't sure that, I think that the mayor and Sewald weren't sure that it had to come back here. But I think that if we already, we meet the 15th, we might as well, we could.
Oh, it's not that, I was talking about the council meeting the 15th. I didn't mean this committee, it's a different date.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We meet the 19th.
Oh, I got the, I'm sorry, I got the dates wrong. I got the dates wrong. So, and that calendar's no good either. So the 19th, when we meet the 19th, then it would go again to Legislative Matters in January. And the other question was, I think we need to take some action. Pam, you might know this, is it the end of every year where we need to carry things into the next session?
Or 2 years.
So it's not, so it's not just
the term.
Okay.
So I'd like to suggest, I don't know exactly how, if this would just be an informal suggestion, that we not necessarily recommend it come back here. I don't know, I mean, we've been, of course, integrally involved in the wording and all of that, but it really is at this point kind of a technical, they're technical pieces, the TIF and the CPA language. So, I mean, if you feel that you want to see it, I think that's fine, but it would slow us down quite a bit. Because it would have to go to Legislative Matters after this committee. It would put us all the way into probably the second meeting in January till we could actually consider it for first reading.
Right.
As whereas if it didn't come here, it could go directly to Ledge,
I was gonna say, as a practical matter, it probably doesn't make much of a difference
I was thinking that too.
Because the licenses come up April 1st anyway, so you basically have until April 1st before all the license renewals happen.
Yeah, you're saying in terms of any of this affecting license applications, yeah.
But I was just thinking about it in terms of getting this wage theft, you know, the executive order, you know, done and established. We'd rather have it done sooner rather than later.
And I don't know where the cycle is for CP.
CPC, I did check with that too, because I saw Jeff Jones at the Worker Center, and what did he say? He said they...
The meetings,
CPC,
they just had a meeting a few days ago.
He said it's something like the fourth Thursday or something like that. It's like a...
I can look here.
It's something that, you know, when I thought about it at the moment, it seemed it could come here, it could go to CPC, and then it could, it would still take it into January, but...
Yeah. I mean, maybe there's no way around it.
Yeah, I think it's, if it's not the second meeting, the earliest it would be the first, and I think at that point. So I'm a little frustrated because I thought I had an ordinance change with specific language, but the difference is that there's some references to state law in the proposed language that the carpenters were hoping we could include. They just seem to think that reiterating that piece in the ordinance really does make a difference to developers, and the piece about the clawback. So
timing wise, the CPC would meet on December 7th. We referred it, if we brought this forward on December 1st, it could be referred to the CPC. Their meeting would be December 7th. Legislative matters, one of you is on that, or both of you?
I'll weigh in on legislative matters, so it would be...
But you have to, legislative matters has to have it after anyone else has.
So in our meeting, this committee meeting
19th.
Would be on the 19th. And so both of those committees would have to review for it to go to legislative matters. And legislative matters is when? I don't see it on the...
It's always the second Monday.
The second Monday.
Right, so that happens before this meeting.
So that would be the 12th. Right, so this is definitely putting us... They wouldn't be able to get it until their meeting in January.
Right, they'd get it on the 12th.
No, they won't get it on the 12th of December. They'd have to wait until January.
January 12th, right. And then we would get it the second, that 12th. Second meeting.
It's January 9th. And then we'd get it back after that. So that our first vote would be the second Thursday, the 19th of January,
right,
when we could do the first vote on it.
I don't think you'll be voting on the executive order though, right?
No.
No, this would be the ordinance.
But he said he would want to roll his executive order out with when we were going to be considering the CPA change in the
That's all licenses. Assuming that the committees don't have a problem with it. I mean, the CPC doesn't have questions and issues.
Right, there may be some amendments or there may be something that...
So this could be a while.
Right.
That's unfortunate, but it seems to be the reality.
Right. I mean, it seems simple, and most people like, so for the CPC committee, it would just mean that applicants similarly check off an affidavit type of form that just says that they're in compliance with wage and hour law. And there would probably be a reference on a form like that that would, if there was the clawback language, that would, you know, pretty much say that if during the course of this contract there is a finding of, you know, wage and hour law, then we can ask for the money back.
Councilor Carney, there was also a question that came up at the last meeting that we had about out-of-state companies. Was that answered? Did Attorney Sewell have an answer to that question when we met with him?
I don't remember that. Oh,
because there were out-of-state construction companies that wouldn't necessarily have filings in Massachusetts AG's office.
Somebody might.
And so there was a question about whether or not there would be a mechanism by which we could follow up with out-of-state companies as well, particularly in the construction industry.
Yeah, I don't remember there being an answer to that.
And I think Lisa Clausen is going to talk to the folks in Cambridge about what the, and Boston, about what they did about that.
Okay.
So we might be waiting to hear back from Lisa too.
Okay.
All right, so those were, that's another outstanding question we have to resolve.
Can anyone can refer something to a committee, right? So, I mean, we don't, right?
You mean out of the council floor?
Right. Mm-hmm. So we can't necessarily control whether or not it comes back here. I mean, I guess, as chair, I could say, you know, we discussed it. We could ask for it, but also if someone wanted to refer it to us, I could make a case for the fact that, you know, I both of you have worked on it. I sit on legislative matters, so I would see it there. But of course, if you wanted it to come here, if anyone else did, that would.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, given the amount of time that we've spent on it, hearing testimony and the conversations we've had about it, it would seem, just in terms of procedure, kind of appropriate for it to come back here after mm-hmm. after all of this. But you know, if it were to come back here, you know, I can tell you right now what would be my questions, and I don't know if you want to talk some about it.
I mean, I think we should stick to what we have on the agenda for now, because either, you know, we'll have an opportunity to talk about it more.
But I guess I would go down in favor of it coming back here. It would just seem appropriate. And I realize that if it wasn't, I've got other outlets for getting my questions asked and answered, but just as a matter of procedure, it would seem appropriate.
Okay. Right. And the meatiest part of the legislation is the executive order, actually, which we don't really consider.
Right.
So these are ways to be kind of adjunct to that.
But presumably we would have access to a draft of that executive order when considering orders and ordinances, so we just understand how the whole thing fits together.
But if it comes out under orders and ordinances and executive, comes under communications from the mayor.
Mm-hmm. Unless the mayor decides to put something in his administrative order.
I mean formally. I mean
see it.
I would just hope that informally we would know a little bit about what's in the executive order that's brewing, so that we'd know how the two fit together.
Right. Well, there is, you know, a draft. Unfortunately, like I said, I was waiting for language back from Alan Seawald's office, but I was hoping to get today, or I might have been able to circulate that around.
I think that's a good point, I think you're making, Council Bidwell, because my understanding from the mayor is that he wasn't going to kind of announce it until we brought it to the floor for vote, so
right.
It wouldn't be until, you know, February or whatever.
January 19th.
Yeah, if we're lucky.
Yeah.
January 19th, he would come to the same meeting where we're going to do the first vote, and he would announce it and explain it. So if we have questions before that, if you have questions before that, then we have to figure out some mechanism, some, I suppose, informal mechanism by which we can have a conversation with the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
We could invite him to our next meeting.
Exactly.
Well, I don't think it's inappropriate to even address some of the questions that you probably have based on that rough draft that everybody has seen. Because I think what Alan did was he took most of what around that rough draft, and he used that. He formatted things, you know, made things appropriate to our, you know, legislation. But do you have? I mean, I don't think it's inappropriate to just address.
I know some of this has been asked an answer before, and I don't recall everything that was in that draft ordinance, so maybe it was all clear in there. But, I mean, the job question for me remains wanting to be really clear about where investigative and enforcement responsibilities lie, and to be absolutely certain that we raise no expectations that at the city level we have that capacity.
Well, as I understand it, now that the mayor has taken this on, he uses Cindy to administer all the license things presently. So she administers all applications as they come in. Similarly, as part of the application process, there would be the form whereby an applicant would make, you know, attest to compliance, or what they have is an option. If they have a finding against them in the previous 3 years, they can secure a wage bond. And that's what a form would entail. Mm-hmm. So what Cindy's job would then be just to look at the two check boxes. Yes, I'm in compliance. No. Oh, and then it means I have a wage bond that because I have findings against me, so I'm submitting a wage bond.
So what if a member in this process, a member of the community, comes forward to the mayor and says, I have reason to believe that their assertion that they're in compliance is not accurate?
Then the city would want to follow up on that. They would want to know that a employer, an applicant, a license holder of the, you know, that license holder is fraudulent, is being fraudulent on their application form. I would want to follow up on that.
But what is the
call the AG's office?
Okay, so that,
the AG's
so that's
office
the question.
Lets them know that there's been a finding or not.
That clarified.
And the mayor is okay with that. I mean, okay. He's willing to have staff on dedicated.
Part of the rationale too is strengthening the relationships between municipalities and the AG's office.
Okay, I just want to be sure that poor Cindy wasn't expected to investigation to find out if there's merit to this claim.
Saw the merit to this in terms of being able to understand what the status is.
So the job of the mayor's office in a situation like that, if there's some question, to refer to the AG's office.
Well, they would also, if they called the AG's office and saw that this applicant in fact has a finding against them, and they checked off that they don't have any findings, then that would raise some issues in terms of the license commission. That would say, well, why would you lie on your application? And I mean, there's a lot of things a lot of concern that I think would be highlighted.
Well, it would also go for adjudication through the AG's office.
Yeah.
So
right.
We wouldn't have a responsibility as a city in any way to then adjudicate the matter.
Right.
Yeah.
It doesn't prohibit
so
them
really
from holding a license.
That phone call that staff people have.
Okay, well, that's how I...
And that doesn't prohibit them from holding a license, because they could also secure a wage bond,
right,
which allows them to, safeguard... Oh, that's Lisa Clausen, right, issues. So, I'm just talking about the same thing.
Right.
She was going to get that information from their lawyer today.
I just, as you've heard me say before, I just don't want to raise the expectation on the part of the public now the city can step in and actually do something about this. And I want to be just clear when all
there
of a sudden
that
what
the
we can
do.
What we can
right.
do and what we
right.
can't.
And
that when it comes to
that.
Investigation and ultimate enforcement power, that's where we have to refer to
the this this doesn't create any mechanism for the city to get the workers' wages back, or anything outside of the AG's process. But it also gives leverage to community groups, to the workers' center trying to advocate on behalf of workers. If they know that there is a brewing situation where somebody's wages are not being paid, or overtime is not being paid for a certain amount of time, or they know that a situation is going on in a particular establishment, they might go forward and say, look, you don't want us to go forward with this, because that's a long process too for anybody who wants to follow it through. Because the part of the reasoning that they could get them to mediate, come to an agreement and fix the situation would be the risk that their license, should there be a finding against them, their risk in that.
Is there anything that the mayor's office would need to provide to the AGs to trigger an investigation? I mean, if someone's came and said, this is what I think, do we need to provide any proof for them to then investigate it?
The message that I'm getting is that the AG's office is going to, you know, take communications from cities and towns very seriously, and they're gonna, I mean, it's a way for cases to bubble up a little more to the top, because they would have the merit of having been at least reviewed by some other governmental, and not reviewed in an official sense, but heard and forwarded. Their level of importance maybe rises, is the thought.
But technically, I think you're asking kind of what, how much work would this entail for the city
right,
to actually get
evidence
them
evidence gathering,
to,
we need to provide
and
to
I don't know the answer to that. What, if there's a form that someone in City Hall would have to fill out to submit to the AG's office, if it's a simple phone call, if it's a simple email that says, you know, we've gotten an allegation against this particular business. Do you know kind of what the actual
what
process
I've heard
is?
It's the process of establishing the relationships between the city and the Attorney General's office, so that it can be, you know, Cindy is a known entity if she calls the AG's office.
But is it as simple as her just calling and saying, we have an allegation against blah, blah, blah?
Well, they would have to be, I mean, the thing would have to obviously be going through, use whatever forms and things in, so their
yes.
office, but you could say, look for this name or case number or whatever may be the case.
So
if someone has already filed.
And things to fill out on our, here in the city.
Yeah, specific to complaints, we don't. It doesn't mean that things couldn't be developed over time as we see how this works out and if people, you know, but I don't, there's nothing in the executive order or in the council order that specifies that.
But in terms of the AG's office, what the process is that they have to work with cities, I guess, would be my question.
Right, and I guess the other, I mean, yes, the question of what work do we have to do, but also, you know, what keeps a call from us to them from kind of falling through the cracks? Like, what, if we say there's this allegation, but we don't provide proof or we don't provide stuff to bolster it, what, you know, how do we know that it will actually be investigated? You know, so we're, in some way, you know, we don't have the ability to do the enforcement ourselves, but then there's a concern about handing it over if we're not sure it will be followed up.
Well, that's what I've been told by Jocelyn Jones, basically. She, if you remember, she came out of the AG's office and now she's doing labor law stuff for Siegel Whitman. So she said, really, it's about just creating those relationships, and that it's those phone calls from cities and towns that would kind of push along a case that they acknowledge full well is completely backlogged and, you know, can take years for something to go through.
Still feels squishy and sort of subjective to me.
Yeah. I don't know that I don't know that there's a formal process. I don't know that they have a particular staff person dedicated to dealing exclusively with cities, because there's only three, right now, that have passed this legislation.
Well, I would think there's something that could be learned from those five, if some of them have a little bit of a head start in figuring out just what are their procedures and protocols and communicating with the Attorney General's office.
Mm-hmm. I'm willing to take on just being in touch with the AG's office, figuring out who the person or people are that we should talk to, and just kind of getting the lowdown from them about what process they might be using with those few cities. I mean, those are all fairly new ordinances to Councilor Bidwell, so they may not have had a lot of experience yet working with them, but asking what they have in place or if they're developing something and what it would entail and what kind of system we as a city would have to set up, you know, whether it be some kind of tickler system so we remember to check in on a periodic basis to see where the claim is at, or but I can ask some questions and bring that information to the next meeting, because I think that is important for us to really understand the whole process from beginning to end. Okay?
Sure.
I mean, I can talk to Jocelyn first, but I can go to the AG's office
directly. She'll give you some
actual
calls. Yeah.
In the AG's office, so I'm sure he can help
hook
me up
okay.
with the right person.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you have any
No, no, I just help my colleagues understand that I'm totally on board with the spirit of this. I just, my concern all along has been just really understand the mechanics of it. And how it would work in practice, combined with this concern about the expectations we raise. And so I'm very clear about what we can and cannot do as a city.
Right, I mean, if we can be clear that really what we're doing is we're saying that we will not grant licenses to people who violate wage and hour law, we won't give CPA grants, and we won't give TIF grants, and we won't give city contracts to people who violate wage and hour law. And if we state that, I mean, that, if I think if we can say that we can do that to the best of our ability by ascertaining that as part of the, you know, RFP process and license application and CPA application.
And to be clear, technically we're not taking allegations from people. I mean, it's their responsibility, as it were, to file a complaint with the AG's office. What we are doing is we're asking companies that are coming for licenses whether or not they have an existing claim against them.
Right.
So it's not the city's responsibility to kind of manage somebody's allegation, essentially.
So to that point, are we building that relationship with the AG's office that Councilor Carney keeps talking about?
Well, I think that some cities and towns do. I mean, it could be that as time goes on and with that relationship and with the comfort level of dealing with these issues, there may be a way that the mayor may choose to take complaints through the mayor's office and forward them along, or put them in touch with someone with the AG's office and then keep that data just for their own purposes. They might want to know how many complaints have we actually had in the city. I'm going to come through this office. And, I mean, it may be that something that would evolve over time.
Okay, any other thoughts on that aspect of that? Can we go back to talk about the arts part of it? Because I feel like I'm not sure we really sort of explained, you know, what we heard from the mayor about that. So he said, you know, sort of what has been my experience, which is that it's not so much that all of these organizations don't get together or don't meet and sort of talk about these things. They do, and there are certain times when they do kind of come together and look at sort of a larger picture. For example, it's totally escaping my mind. We created a
district.
Thank you. You know, those are times where, like, sort of all the players get together and talk about these things. So that does happen. I feel like how Councilor Bidwell characterized it here and sort of how our conversation evolved with the mayor was talking about more like how can we get together and sort of promote and publicize and make known all that is done, all that the city does also for the arts, you know, that we have dedicated staff to this, and sort of a way to do some public education around all the different organizations, including the city, that are involved in the arts, and different ways that people can get involved, so that's sort of what informed what's here. Mm-hmm. Yes.
that's in the last meeting when we were talking about kind of models for how we were going to move forward. That's what I said a couple of times, and I felt like I kind of said it like a broken record a little bit, because I felt like we were being presumptuous, thinking that we were going to somehow convene the mm-hmm. interested parties, because clearly, you know, I know for a fact, and as you're saying, the mayor also said, these different arts organizations in the city do have different reasons that they meet, different committees that they do together. So they're, of course, having those conversations. I think the question is, how do we as a committee, and how do we as a city council bolster the efforts? how do we maybe get engaged with their efforts? How do we amplify their efforts? And so one of the things we talked about is having somebody from this committee kind of liaise to however, whatever bodies they meet in. And I think that that's a model worthy of investigation for how we can contribute. Or maybe have somebody from those committees be a liaison to us, to our committee, or to the council, to come on a regular basis and tell us, give us updates, tell us, you know, what we can do concretely to help support them and amplify the work that they're doing. So it can go either way, depending on how much output of energy we can muster in terms of, you know, someone from here being a liaison to them versus them coming to us. And in the previous, our previous term, we had the Social Services Culture Recreation Committee. We had the Center for the Arts and the Arts Trust and Brian Foote from the Arts Council come to us on a number of occasions to kind of tell us what was going on. And a couple times we invited them to come to the whole city council to kind of make, do an update. So that's kind of already, there's already kind of a model for that, but I would like us to think a little bit more creatively with those organizations about how can we concretely help and what kind of recommendations can we make to city staff and to the mayor about how we can help and amplify their work. So I think that that's a really good direction kind of that the mayor kind of was putting us into. But one of the things we had talked about at the last meeting too, sorry, I'm talking an awful lot, is that I would be in touch with those folks to see what they wanted, kind of to see how, what forums they're meeting in, and do they want someone to come, or maybe would they prefer to have someone be a liaison to us. So if we want to move forward with that process, I can proceed with that. It will proceed because I hadn't heard about the meeting with the mayor.
I think the past practice of having them come to, I mean, just the evolution of our committees has been there was a single dedicated arts and culture committee. That's all that the city council subcommittee did. And then that got absorbed into social services.
Recreation veterans.
Yeah, veterans, yeah. Veterans and arts, right. So, those organizations went from having a regular presence at meetings to a less regular to, I don't know that they're really, and so it would be good to understand whether they find that helpful or.
I feel like I'll just maybe note that, you know, my experience having sat on that committee with you is, I'm not sure that they would come and present, and I felt like we often would hear that they want, there's more that they wanted, but, and I remember asking specifically sometimes, what does that mean? What, and we didn't really get, we could never really get an answer. So I'm just a little bit concerned about sort of starting that cycle again. You know, if there was a more productive way, we could have that conversation where we, where it's less about them sort of complaining and us saying, well, what, how can we help? And then saying, well, I don't know. And then the next year we do it all over again. I would certainly rather not do that.
I guess the spirit in which I threw out this kind of refined notion of a forum, and whether it's a forum or whether it's a meeting of this committee that's devoted to arts and downtown events and marketing and promotion of city. Maybe that makes, since they're present for that, maybe that makes more sense than doing something separate like calling it a forum, whatever. But I from my conversations, and I totally get what I hear here and from the mayor that, wait a minute, these folks are meeting and talking about this stuff all the time, is that there are certain gaps. Like there's a regional tourism council that has a regional tourism strategy. But I don't think there is a downtown marketing strategy per se. And I think it might be worthy of having the relevant groups in the room at the same time to talk about what would it take for there to be a really comprehensive downtown marketing strategy, and the answer would probably be money. And then that dovetails with the question, well, are there any, you know, the question came up here about, well, can we dedicate liquor license revenues to somehow marketing of downtown events? Are there other revenue streams, hotel meals tax, are there other revenue streams where some portion of them can be dedicated? It was more not just having them come in and do their regular updates, but have all of them in the same room addressing a few key questions that they would all have a role in, and combined with this notion of, if combined with some press attention, some Gazette cooperation, could there come out of this some emerging master calendar of events coming up in the next year, combined with volunteers are needed for this, and this. These organizations are looking for board members. So it may be naive to think that all of that could somehow get addressed in one comprehensive meeting devoted to this topic with the arts and the downtown groups. But it might be a jumping off point, at which point there would be follow-up, and it might be, you know, one of us, perhaps you, Councilor Klein, liaising to individual groups as follow-up. But that's kind of what I was thinking about this.
When you say that there are no there's no organization dedicated to downtown marketing, is the DNA not doing that now?
My impression is that they wanted to put that was going to be a second or third year item for them, and that, I mean, not so much there's not a group, there's kind of several groups who have it as part of what they do, but is there sort of a comprehensive downtown marketing strategy and plan? And I believe the answer to that is no. And the regional tourism council, you know, has some experience, but you know they've obviously got by definition a broader purview, though they have gathered a great deal of data that sounds like would be interesting. they have done a study of credit card receipts. They looked at where out of towners really do spend their money, and they're working on such an analysis. And I think you know just to gather that additional information would in itself be of some use, and then might indeed tie into the development of a marketing strategy. And I am certainly not suggesting we develop a downtown marketing strategy. I'm suggesting we put it on the floor that would it make sense for there to be one, and are there ways we could help by exploring revenue streams to make it possible, or something like that.
So do we have other thoughts on this plan for a possible final report? And if we don't, what are our next steps?
I'd like to suggest that, I mean, I think this outline is quite comprehensive, and I wouldn't want to see you put a whole lot more work into it. I think maybe some of these bullet points could be fleshed out, or some of the decisions that we make here could be added, but this actually feels like a nice beginning point for a report, and maybe we can think about towards the end of this term, you know, adding to it if we have outcomes or something like that, but I don't know. If you want to work on it, that's fine too, but I just don't want you to feel like you have to go way further with what you have here. I think this does what we need, you know, provides what we need as a...
Well, I guess that raised the question of, do we come up with a report that includes all these recommendations, or do we just jump right ahead and right now ask the mayor to cooperate in the development of a meeting of this committee dedicated to these arts and events related organizations, and skip the process of a formal report and just move to that. I was thinking we were sort of back to some kind of summary report, including recommendations, but we can skip the report and just move straight to recommending things. And don't get me wrong, I was not volunteering to be the sole author of some kind of report here. I could coordinate the writing of a report if we want to move in that direction, asking others to contribute pieces. But no, it was not my intent to head off and write a report.
Oh, I misunderstood that.
No, it was my...
I don't think we need a report. I mean, I think, as you suggest, we can seek the support of the mayor to meeting the one-time forum. We can, you said you already had the conversation that you had with the mayor, seeing that he's very willing to go along with most of these things, not all of them.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think for my own sense of closure, I would like a report. I don't think it needs to be, you know, a big, giant tome, but, and also, you know, to sort of officially close out the committee study request, we're supposed to have some sort of report, and we kind of did an interim one to kind of get us past that point, but my preference would be to sort of flesh these out a little bit, again, not making it a giant, you know, thing that's going to take us many months, but, you know, I would like us to have something that kind of recaps it and then has sort of more comprehensive requests to the mayor, and makes sort of recommendations to the council. I think that sort of feels like we have done what has been asked of us, and there's more work that we can do, but as a committee, we have fulfilled that request, which would feel really good to me to do that. So I am volunteering to help work on this report that Dennis has said he was just going to do by himself, but, you know, might as well help him.
I didn't think that's what I just said.
I'm totally kidding. I didn't know. Yeah.
But I'm also hearing we don't need a report at all. But I get your sense of closure, completion,
right. Yeah.
Pulling it together, if that can be done without it becoming too exhausted.
Right, and I'm not opposed to a report. I just don't know what I mean.
I don't think, you know, for example, I don't think we need to have the op-ed pieces have been published by the time we've done the report. We could say, you know, these are things that as a committee we're considering doing, that have been informed by this study that we have done.
So this document feels to me like it's a kind of strategic, the beginnings of a strategic plan of what we, kind of suggestions of what we can do. And it seems like the next step is we have to define in each of these categories what we do plan to do. And that to me, and that's what I'm saying, I don't think this has to be developed much beyond this. I think it just kind of has to, the report would say, these are the things we considered. This is what we decided is necessary. This is how we will be moving forward. And that's kind of another interim report. And I think at the end, towards the end of our term, like maybe next August or September, when we just eliminated our August meeting, we could, just write up a paragraph about what we achieved in each of the areas, and that would be the final report to my mind.
You just want to try this out, don't you?
What?
Because they didn't want to try.
I believe our chair was hoping that this report would in fact be the end.
Okay, so this could be the final report, but I think it would be useful for us at the end of our term to kind of just recap, you know, what we have been working on as a committee that, that relates to this.
Certainly.
So we can change the, you know, the terms we're using for this.
Right.
But that's why I'm saying, I'm not saying that we shouldn't do a report, but I do think that this is laying everything out, and we just have to kind of come up with our very specific recommendations based on these suggestions. And that's all that I think needs to be in a report personally. Just.
Well, I, you know,
less complicated.
I would certainly be glad to work with you, Councilor Shara, in fleshing this out a little bit as that kind of report. I think it might make sense if we do think there's some merit to, whether we call it a forum or it's just a meeting of this committee devoted to these arts and events topics, to begin doing, you know, we talked about just sort of a small planning group that would actually plan such a session and take this list of topics and refine them and refine the invite list and work on an agenda for such a thing. And maybe Councilor Klein, if you and Brian Foote and Suzanne Beck at the Chamber is very much interested in participating, were to be your own little planning group to take a rough outline here, which would also be incorporated in this report, and meet with those folks and explore. Does it make sense to come together? Are these the kind of topics that would be worthy of conversation?
I think that my inclination would be to maybe convene a meeting with 5 or 6 people, a small one, you know, 1.5 hour meeting with the people you suggested, and then someone from the Arts Trust and someone from the Center for the Arts, and say, what do you prefer, a one-shot meeting where we talk about these topics, or that we do an ongoing kind of conversation? Because again, I don't feel like it makes sense for one of us to kind of come into what they may already be thinking about and have established. They might not feel like it's useful to do a one-shot forum. So I mean, mm-hmm. I'm just inclined to ask the folks in the community already working on these issues, what they would see as most useful.
Mm-hmm.
So before we would make that decision, that recommendation for at least this arena, I'd want to talk to them first,
mm-hmm.
convene them somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Could even do a teleconference with, 5 or 6 people.
Mm-hmm.
But do you feel like we couldn't do a report before that happened? Because
No, we can just lay out those
possibilities. Right, so this is something we're interested in doing.
Right, and we recommend that a small working group explore what would be the best way to do it.
Right.
And similarly similarly on panhandling and at-risk downtown populations.
Can I know this is a pain for people, but we just philosophically and socially, I would love it if we could talk about the at-risk downtown populations and how we can be helping them without talking about panhandling as like the centerpiece of what we're trying to get at. I think that we're talking about people in their lives, people who are in, rough circumstances a lot of the time, people who are doing the best they can and using downtown in particular ways, yes, but I think the focus should be on them and their lives more than on the issue of panhandling. I find that that's really reductionist, and it's just, to me, it's very problematic, and I'd like it if this committee would be willing to kind of talk about, I think we should worry about our at-risk population in the city and how it may affect the downtown, but use the term panhandling as kind of the centerpiece of how we talk about this is just, it bothers me personally.
I certainly understand. I mean, and I feel likewise, which is why I added the at-risk aspect to it. It's hard because, you know, obviously we don't control the conversation. We control our conversation. We don't control the larger conversation. They are more than conflated, and it is certainly how it's been framed when people come to us. I certainly take your point, and I would like any discussions that we have to always be broader than panhandling. But also, you know, the work that the mayor said is already sort of underway is, I think, has both elements involved in it. So we can certainly make, in our recommendation, we can say this is, we can indicate that how this is how we like, we would like it to be framed, but I don't think we can totally control that, for sure.
To me, there's a difference between approaching people with compassion and approaching people with a pejorative, shaming framing. And I think that when we use panhandling as the first approach, it is necessarily shaming and pejorative. So I think that part of the leadership that we can show and use is to shift the way that we talk about it so that the conversation could potentially shift in the city. And I know, I mean, I absolutely acknowledge and I understand that there are many people who are very upset with panhandlers, and that's how they come to us. I've had a number of people come to me directly and say that. However, you know, I respond to them, you know, I understand your concern, and I speak from a place of compassion for the people who are in a position where they are asking for money on the street. And I would really love it if we can model that, I think, for the rest of the city.
Certainly.
I totally hear that. But I think we can't be blind to the fact that and there's data from outreach workers working downtown that and anecdotes that in addition to Northampton residents who are experiencing a variety of hardships and illnesses and addictions and health issues, there is a growing percentage of the folks who are, quote, panhandling, if you'll let me use that term for another sentence or two, who are not Northampton residents, who in fact are live outside of Northampton, who are not homeless, who come into Northampton and set up shop for the day, in some cases in almost sort of regular office hours. And it's some of those people that really create, from the standpoint of some property owners and merchants, like a continuing not welcome presence. And I think we have to, particularly having heard as many people as we did from all sorts of perspectives come to us and talk about this, I think we have to be aware of that too. And so I think we need to find a way, and that's why if anything were to ever go forward, the messaging of this is incredibly complicated. To convey compassion and eagerness to be of assistance in lining people up with necessary services, but also acknowledging that there's another thing going on, and I think we need to address both.
And I don't want to drag this on, but as a council, we've dealt with this issue, you know, a couple of times, at least three times since I've been on the council, you know, pretty in depth. And, you know, even I understand what you're saying, Dennis, I just, No, I think it, what we can get caught up in whether or not the people who are on our street are in, I mean, doesn't matter if they're residents or not, they still are, have a constitutional right to panhandle, to ask for money, to solicit. It's on the streets, and it doesn't matter if they're, you know, and I think what happens is we get caught up in, well, it would be okay if they were Northampton residents, or it would be okay if they were in fact homeless and not, you know, just living in a rundown place. Or there's a lot of things that, you know, people say that, well, use as reasons why it's not okay. It's not okay that they're on, that, you know, people are soliciting for money on our streets. And I, you know, I mean, it, that's why, and it's why I, part of why I wrote the Vibrant Sidewalks resolution too. I mean, it's like, as a community, unless we say that they are part of our streets. They are part of our street culture. And yes, we should address needs of those who are at risk, who are downtown, and make sure that we do that, and address the needs of businesses. And I think that we're bending over backwards, really trying to do what we can as a city, and really to try to address the needs of the downtown economy. I think that we're doing a pretty good job of that. And I don't think that, I think as long as we accept the premise that one of those things is to acknowledge the quote unquote problem of panhandling, and as Councilor Klein said, framing it in that, in those terms, we'll continue to come back to think, saying that this is something that we should do. We should help the people who are at need so that they no longer panhandle, is the presumption. But I think that we don't want to necessarily make that assumption, because there are people who may be, you know, independently wealthy and just choose to ask for money on the street because that's what they want to do. And we know that in other cultures in the world, it's a religious, it's required. Asking for money is required, and giving money is required in some parts of the world as a religious premise. So I think we, you know, we do a lot when we take this on and continue to talk about it in terms of, even though we heard concerns, we know that this, we know that there are business owners that have concern with panhandling. But I don't think that, but taking away or somehow attempting to stop someone else's right to ask for money on the public street, on the public sidewalk, is not the answer.
It's not, and I'm aware of no one that would want to put forward any kind of resolution or ordinance suggesting that the right to ask for money on the streets be taken away. That, I mean, that would never fly. We know that. What the spirit of some of these alternative approaches taken in other cities that Jonathan did some research on, a number of social service agencies in town and Peg Keller have researched, is that we as a city also have the right to produce a program that provides people walking along the street with an alternative way of helping at-risk populations. That we have every right, if we want, to provide some mechanism by which folks can either give to people directly when they put their hat out on the street, or to give to a fund that will directly go to mental health services and
like
health services,
and,
like the frog, but a more but a differently messaged, more sophisticated, more comprehensive way of doing that, taking advantage of technologies, including they're you know, not now, just text. Text your contribution, and this month it's going to mental health services. Next month it's going to food pantry. Next month it's going to shelter, and there are alternative ways of providing those dollars directly to the service providers working with these populations. And what that would do, it would mean that if And might it decrease the actual cash flow going into people on the street? It might, but that's up to somebody who's walking down the street, which way they're gonna give. It's not telling somebody, you can no longer sit here and put up your sign. They're still gonna do that. There might over time be fewer folks giving dollars to that way and choosing the alternative way.
I'm just reminded of the campaign, and you probably remember, and was it 6 or 8 years ago? But it was the campaign to stop, basically there was, do you remember? So it said, stop giving to panhandlers. You don't know, and then the unfortunate part was, you don't know how they're using the money. They're maybe using it for drugs, they're maybe.
That's what I mean by the messaging,
right.
It has to be very,
really unfortunate.
Very
yeah.
Sophisticated.
I mean, there was a counter, then of course there was a counter thing that was just, don't give money to business owners. You don't know if they're using it going to Foxwoods or whatever else. So, I mean, I think that it just, I think what you're talking about is giving people an alternative. You're talking about coming up with a way to give people an alternative if they should choose. If they want to give, if they want to be charitable, but they don't want to put money into someone's cup, there would be an official, some sort of way that we publicize. You can, rather than give money directly to panhandlers, you can give to social service agencies that will help them in the long run.
Hopefully with better messaging and better technology than the last time it was tried.
I see.
And I say that because I know that there's a lot of thought been given to that, and I get the sense, and Peg Keller would agree with this, that the housing organizations and the service providers that she works with and their outreach workers on the street are very much aware that the level of seriousness about this issue has risen, and it's time to return, to sit around the table and address it again. And I'm not suggesting that we, as council members, be seated around that table, but I think it's appropriate that we officially recommend to the mayor that he build on this interest that's out there and convene such a group. And we can, for what it's worth, we can suggest some topics, but ultimately it'd be that group. And we have reason to believe that if there were some encouragement and blessing from the council, that would give it a little boost, a little heft.
And I think that the only issue that I have is that I would probably feel better about it, there's a way that this can be presented that doesn't label panhandlers as being a problem. And I don't know how, you know, I mean, I don't know if you can do both, but I think that we can say is that certain people, some business owners, some residents, some certain people have real issues and problems with people panhandling on the streets. And we respect the, and at, I think we need to be clear that we respect the right of everybody to be on the street. And that we have already said in a resolution that they contribute to the downtown vibrancy. I mean, maybe people would want to get rid of that, but we pretty much said that they are part and parcel. They and street fairs and protests and all sorts of things go into making
a vibrant downtown.
Right.
I don't see anything that, and any of the proposals that I've heard that are being looked at as being inconsistent with the spirit of vibrant sidewalk.
The only thing that I'm saying is that if we're saying in our recommendations that we're considering panhandling to be a problem, or that it's something that we're hoping to decrease, even as in our bullet point there. I mean, I think that we want to be clear that we're also saying that we respect the rights of people who are panhandling to be there.
The problem, it's not very counselorly to cry, but, you know, we keep talking about this, and this is, to me, let me compose myself. This kind of reminds me of talking about the prison population. So we know that something like 95% of women who are incarcerated have been sexually abused either as children or raped as adults. we know that people who suffer from mental illness have had all kinds of intensely adverse experiences in their lives. We as a society are really good at responding after the fact, responding to, you know, far down the line when people start exhibiting behaviors, you know, whether they be criminal behaviors or panhandling behaviors or mental illness. And there's always, there are kind of value judgments attached to the ways in which we respond and react. And there's not, in my opinion, enough focus on where people, what happened to them in their lives to get to this point. And when we start talking about panhandlers and needing to, you know, reduce the number of panhandlers, and we are necessarily devaluing their lives and what they've been through that brought them to the point of doing something that is not quote unquote socially acceptable. And I don't want to be a part of that. And I feel like this council needs to think really clearly about what our values are about people and what we as a society haven't done to keep people safe and get everything that they need as they're coming up in the world, so that they aren't resorting to criminal behaviors, panhandling behaviors, mental, you know, not ending up with mental illness issues. So that to me is just such an incredibly foundational piece of how I would want this ever talked about. And there's just this way in which we are devaluing the people who, you know, are for whatever reason are on the streets doing something that is not socially acceptable. It takes somebody, they're on a long path that brought them to that place, because it is considered socially unacceptable. And it's a hard thing to do in our bourgeois, you know, Western, upper middle class town of Northampton. So I feel like, I've said this in past meetings, I don't want to be a part of promoting this framing. And I think we have to think really carefully about how it would be framed in the future for me to ever feel like it's something that I could talk about. I know that I'm not articulating myself very well because it makes me very, I feel very vulnerable talking about this, but I feel really strongly about it.
I think you've articulated yourself very well.
Thank you.
Certainly. Would it be okay if I attempted at framing it? And then if we come together at our next meeting and we talk about it and we revise it?
Yeah.
I mean, certainly I wouldn't want us to put a report where you have, you know, a minority dissension from it. You know, I would like us to come together as a committee and be able to put forward a report that we all feel comfortable with. Would that be okay?
Yeah, okay. I just want to say, I realize, you know how like you think back about what you're saying when I talked about the 95% of women who are incarcerated have been sexually abused. That was one example that I was trying to offer of, you know, the things that happen to people in their lives and how we react after the fact as a society, but we're not, you know, creating the foundations that people need to not get to points of distress, essentially. So I just want to make clear that I wasn't implying that everyone who's panhandling was sexually abused or something along those lines.
I know
you're all smart enough to figure that out.
Okay.
Example.
Yes. Okay.
Good luck with that, Pam, in the minutes.
Do we have any other further discussion about this? And do we feel comfortable with Councillor Bidwell and I working on creating something that we can bring in December? We feel like we can do this, we can pull this off, you and me?
We can give it a shot.
We can give it a shot. So we are going to attempt to bring something to us in December. And then we can put out there, and then, you know, again, that doesn't stop our work. It just sort of hopefully completes this request and kind of gives us a clear.
So does that mean that we're not proceeding until we've defined what our action steps are? Like, should I go ahead and kind of try and talk to people about convening a first meeting around the arts, or are we waiting until we highlight that as a recommendation, for instance, for the arts section? I mean, December's not the best time anyway.
Right, my preference would be like, let's get this out and then, and then it's sort of, we've sort of very publicly stated what we're gonna do and then take steps forward.
If it weren't for the fact that it's such a crazy time of year, I would think it might make sense for some of those feeler exploratory conversations, because it would, as you've said, inform the direction that we take here. I would think that might make some sense, but we're very much aware of the press of the calendar, and a lot of those folks are especially busy this time of year. So maybe it makes sense for us to, Councilor Bashar and I, to take a stab at this and then see where we're at in December, and then see if we want to go forward with conversations with arts groups, conversations with the mayor about the at-risk downtown population and whatever we're calling panhandling by that time.
Okay, any?
I was just thinking, I call someone from, you know, the Center for the Arts and say, I know you're planning first night, but we need to have a meeting now.
Yeah, I know. It's a pretty.
I think it's a lucky time in the calendar that gives us a little bit of breathing. How about that? Let's frame it that way. How about that? Okay, so closing out that discussion. Okay. Good about that. Does anybody have any new business? I do not have any new business.
Yep. I want to say a really quick thing, and that is, I just want to thank Pam for the notes. They're remarkable. I mean,
yes,
you
yes, yes.
capture everything, and it's...
Whether we want to capture it or not.
Yeah, it's such a useful tool for
do you do shorthand?
Moving forward all the time.
No,
not wow. really. But she goes back and you watch the...
Yeah. Oh!
Yeah. No, she invests an amazing wow. amount of time.
Yeah.
We're incredibly grateful.
Yeah.
It does, it makes...
It's incredibly helpful.
Yeah.
Makes our job.
Yeah. It's incredible. It's an invaluable thing that you do for us. So thank you so much.
And not just for us, but for the city, right? Because
yes.
and people can look at our minutes and actually know what we talked about, as opposed to like very rough.
And
outline.
You do this times how many committees and commissions? And
it's only four or five. So it's not all that. It really isn't. I mean, some of the meetings are pretty fast, and you know, not all that beefy. You know?
Not everyone talks as much as me.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's
all.
That's a very nice bit of new business for you, I know. Okay, so I will hear a motion to.
I would make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Okay.
Have a
nice
wonderful holiday.
Safe
right.
travels.
Right.
Thank you, everyone else as well. Good. So do you get like a great
are you cooking
spot on the plane?
No.
You don't?
Well,
we did our guide guarantee.
That's the one we made.
No.